This is a 1997 Toyota Century, and it's one of the most impressive luxury cars ever made. It's also almost completely unknown here in North America because the Toyota Century is pretty much only sold in Japan. But in Japan, it is considered the luxury sedan to have if you run a big business or if you run the country. Today, I'm going to review this Century and show you what makes it so special. I've borrowed this Century here in Southern California from a viewer, and it's an impressive car for many reasons. Now, I've already reviewed a Century, but that was the first generation model with a V8. This is the second generation Century, and it's on a totally different level. And it has a V12. Yes, that's right, a Japanese car with a V12 engine. In fact, this era of Toyota Century is the only Japanese production car ever made with a V12. But it makes sense that that engine is in the Century because this is sort of like the ultra-luxury sedan to have in Japan. It's probably the quietest, most serene Japanese car ever made. And when you see one on the street, you can generally be sure that a chauffeur is driving around passengers. Pricing for the Century is actually more expensive than the Lexus LS, which is the flagship Lexus luxury sedan sold here in North America. So why would wealthy people want a Toyota instead of a BMW 7 Series or a Mercedes S-Class or a Bentley? Actually, it's simple. The Century is primarily used by Japanese business people and politicians and other rich people who don't want to be seen in an imported car. They want to drive Japanese. And that's one of the primary reasons why the Century isn't exported to other markets. But this Century is right here in North America, and today I'm going to review it. First, I'm going to take you on a tour of this Century, and I'm going to show you all of the interesting quirks and features of the Japanese ultra-luxury sedan. Then I'm going to get it out on the road and drive it, and then I'm going to give it a Doug score. All right, I'm going to start the quirks and features of the Century in the logical place, the back seat, because that's where the chauffeur-driven passengers will sit in one of these. And the first thing you notice when you look back here is that you don't have leather seats in this ultra-luxury car. Instead, you have cloth. Actually, it's wool cloth, and this is completely intentional. Toyota creates the Century to provide the most serene, quiet experience possible, and cloth makes less noise when you sit down or when you move around than leather does, and so having cloth seats is quieter, and that's why they choose cloth. Now, speaking of the seat material, another item you'll notice is that there's lace covering up a portion of the seats. In the backrest of the seats and the headrest, you have lace back here. This is a fairly common practice in Japan, and it's to protect the seat fabric from people sitting on it, much like your grandmother might have done with a sofa. Interestingly, you get into a taxi in Japan to this day, and a lot of them still have lace on the seats for this reason. But anyway, let's move on to some of the more impressive quirks of the ultra-luxury Century. I want to start in the center. Between the two front seats facing back, you have an upright console here, and it has this bird on it. This is some sort of bird from Japanese mythology. I call it the majestic chicken, and it appears in various places throughout the car. But anyway, you open up the panel with the majestic chicken, and you see a television. This car has a television for the rear seat passengers, which is a wonderful luxury. There's even a remote that says Century on it, a Century-specific television remote. That is when you know you have a true luxury good. Also, in that little panel next to the remote, you have a little storage area where I guess you can put stuff, like, for example, the latest issue of TV Guide. And next up, the other interesting thing about that center console there is you can see above the panel with the television, there are two climate vents. So you have center climate vents for the rear passengers right in the middle there to blow air on you when you adjust the climate control temperature. And next up, another excellent ultra luxury feature here is the ability to lie down. You see how there's a handle on the back of the front passenger seat? Well, if you pull on that handle, the entire middle of the seat comes down towards you, and that gives you one kind of unbroken lounge chair position so you can sit back here and completely lie down. Some cars have a control for the front passenger seat where you can move it out of the way. In this car, you actually just use the front passenger seat to extend your body and relax completely as your chauffeur drives you around. And I have to say, this is pretty nice. And next up, we move on to all of the electronics in the center of this car. Now, to access them, you put down this center armrest. This giant center armrest comes down and it reveals a lot of different controls. Actually, I'll start with the most mundane item in this center console. You have cup holders, two of them, one for each side. You can stick drinks in there, pretty simple. Now, above that, you have your stereo controls. So this is to turn on the radio, the CD player, that sort of thing. These are all the controls for that that the backseat passenger has access to. Now, if you go above that, you can flip up this piece of cloth, and that gives you access to all of your seat controls. The seats back here actually move. You can see you press the control and the seat will recline, move up, down, slide forward or backwards, so the rear seat passengers can have the optimum level of comfort. These controls, though, are unusually comprehensive. For example, you can adjust the rear headrest forward, backward, up, or down. Four different electronic adjustments just for the headrest back here, which is pretty impressive. To me, though, the very best part of the Century rear armrest is this little device. You can see it says Century on it, and if you open it up, you can stick a cassette tape in there. That is a recorder. The way it works is this little cord is plugged in the rear center armrest, and if you want to record something, you press this microphone button further up in the center control area, and then it starts recording to your Century branded tape recorder device. The theory here is you have a Century, so you're an important business person being chauffeured around, so you might want to dictate something while you're driving or just record one of your brilliant ideas, and so you can do that using the microphone button and the Century tape recorder in the middle. Also impressive back here, you can see there's a little case that says Century on it. That is for the headphones. This car comes with Century branded headphones. So if you want to listen to the radio or to your cassette recordings, you can use your Century headphones. Just plug them in and then you can listen. You don't have to use crappy regular headphones. Now, one interesting thing with this rear armrest, it's not just controls. There's actually a cover to this. And if you put the cover down, then you can see it just becomes an armrest again. So if you don't want to record anything or change the radio station, you can just use it for comfort. And next up, we move on to some other interesting ultra-luxury rear seat quirks and features. I want to move on to the door panel where you have individual ashtrays. Open this up, you have an ashtray and you have a cigarette lighter on both doors, so rear seat passengers don't have to share their ashes or their cigarette lighting. Another item you have over on the door panel, of course, is the button to turn on the heated seat. Even though this car has cloth seats, they are heated. That button is how you turn them on. But probably the most interesting item on the door panel is the button next to the heated seat. That turns on the seat massager. You press that button, you turn it on, and the seat vibrates a lot very quickly. It's not one of these really high quality massages like you get in modern luxury cars, but you did have kind of an early version of a massaging seat in the back, which is really luxurious. And next up, some other ultra luxury quirks and features back here. I'm gonna move on to the ceiling, where you have a few items right above the door opening. One is another climate vent to make sure you get the air that you want. Next to that climate vent, you have a light. This is a reading light. You can turn it on or off to assist with your reading. The interesting thing is this light has a dimmer, so you can actually dim it all the way bright or all the way dim, depending on how you prefer your reading light. Also in this area, you have an absolutely massive grab handle, far bigger than what you get in basically any other car. I guess this is to assist you in getting out, but also you could use it as a hanger for coats if you want to store your coat on this grab handle while you're being chauffeured along. Either way, it's huge. And next up, another interesting roof item. At the center of the roof, you have a clock pointed toward the rear seat passengers. This obviously allows you to tell the time without having to look up and see the clock in the front, making life a little bit more luxurious. Next up, another notable item. This one is on the floor in the center. Open up this cubby and you have a storage compartment, and it is huge, quite large. It's like 8 or 10 inches long and pretty big, so you can put stuff in here. And as you can see, there's a lid, so you can close it up and then put away whatever you want. Right above that, you have yet another storage compartment. This one is a little bit smaller, but another option for storage for rear seat passengers. Next up, one other notable item in the back seat. When you open the door, you can see this car has rear side airbags. Now that's pretty impressive. The very first car with front side airbags was the Volvo 850, which came out in 1993, and I think it added the side airbags in 94. But for many years after that, rear side airbags were still tremendously rare. This Century is a 97, like I mentioned, and I wouldn't be surprised if it is the first or one of the first cars to ever have side airbags for the rear seats. But you would expect nothing less from the Ultra Toyota. And next up, we move on to the front seat of the Century, where, as you can imagine, there are quite a few more interesting quirks and features. I'm going to start with the door panel. As you can see, it's pretty similar to the door panel in back, although on the driver's side, you have extra window switches, of course, because the driver can lower all of the windows and not just the window closest to the driver's seat. But there are a couple of unusual items on the driver's door panel. For example, this little switch will raise or lower the position of the seat belt anchor. So if you fire your chauffeur and get another one, and your new chauffeur is shorter than your last, just press this button, the seatbelt whirs down to make the transition easier. Another interesting item on this door panel, you have two heated seat controls. Apparently, that's to turn on the driver heated seat and the passenger heated seat. For some reason, the driver has access to do that. Seems like a strange decision, but that's what they've done in the Century. And next up, moving further into the interior, I have to say the gauge cluster is amazing. Just look at this. It's like a screen. It goes completely dark when the car is off. And when it's on, you have the speed you're traveling directly in the middle and very few other distractions. There's not all sorts of excessive information in here. In fact, you'll notice you won't even find a tachometer in this gauge cluster, which is unusual of cars from this era. Although it is worth noting that the engine speed is printed digitally below the speedometer. So you have a digital speedometer and tachometer in this car, which is very unusual. Now, next up, one thing I find surprising is that even though this is the ultra luxury Toyota intended for chauffeur-driven passengers, there are some carryover parts with other Toyota models. For example, the turn signal stalk, pretty standard out of most Toyotas from this era. The wiper stalk, same deal, pretty standard out of most Toyotas. Obviously, in this car, they're flipped because this one is right-hand drive. Same deal with the steering wheel. This is out of basically every other Toyota from this period. My dad had a 98 Toyota Camry with this exact same steering wheel, although it didn't have the screaming chicken in the middle. Instead, it simply had the Toyota logo. But all that stuff, pretty standard from any Toyota of this era. And next up, we move on to the center console in the Century, and you can see a couple of buttons here with seats on them. These buttons move the front passenger seat. So if you're carrying around a passenger in back and that person doesn't want to be bothered to use their own buttons to move the front passenger seat, you, the driver, can move the seat forward to give your rear passenger a little bit more room. Now, further up from those buttons in the center console and moving on to the center control stack, this is all fairly standard stuff. The first thing you see on the bottom, that is the radio, stereo controls, all your usual stuff. Not all that different from what you'd find in basically any other Toyota from this era. You go up from that and you have your climate controls. Again, fairly standard, nothing particularly unusual here that I can tell, although maybe I'm missing some crazy features because they're written in Japanese. I wouldn't really know. Now, above that, you have a center screen. And when you turn the car on, I love the startup image reminding you that you have a Century and not just some crappy, boring Toyota. This screen is very small, and of course it is not a touch screen. Instead, it's controlled with these little buttons on either side. These buttons, though, are all in Japanese. I have no idea what they do, but when you press them, they beep So they must be doing something. I just don't really know exactly what it is. It seems to be mostly stereo stuff, your CD player, your radio presets, that sort of thing is in that screen. And speaking of that screen and the stereo, this car has a CD player, which was pretty advanced for 1997. It's actually better than that. It has a CD changer, and it's located in the glove box. You can see the CD player, or as they call it, the Toyota Multi-CD Play. Which is interesting, but that's where you stick your CDs. Now, also in the glove box, you have the owner's manuals for this car. Again, they are all in Japanese, so I can't really read them, but it is notable that they have on their cover the majestic chicken, because you would expect nothing less. Next up, another great quirk in the front seats. You put down the visors, they're pretty normal sun visors, nothing unusual here. The quirk comes above the rear view mirror where there is another separate sun visor for this tiny little area, just so no sun at all can get in and blind your chauffeur. I especially like that this tiny visor is covered in cloth. Some cars have these, but they're usually plastic, but not in the Century. It's a little bit more luxurious. And next, we move on to this car's craziest quirk and probably its most impressive feature, and that would be the engine, the V12. Take a close look, because you are not gonna see another V12 engine in a Toyota. Most of the engine is covered by plastic, but you can tell it is a very large engine, of course. And you have this prominent V12 badge right on the top of this plastic engine cover, which I love. Doesn't say Toyota, doesn't say Century, no majestic chicken under here, just V12. That's all you really have to say. Now, the V12 in this era of Century is a 5-liter V12, which is fairly small as V12s go, and Toyota undoubtedly chose this engine for its smoothness. It has only 276 horsepower, which is easily achievable with a V8 or a 6-cylinder, but the theory is by making the engine larger, it can deliver that power in a much smoother fashion, and that's exactly what happens here. So that's why the Century has a V12. Now, one interesting Century item here, a little history lesson. There have been three generations of Toyota Century. I already reviewed the first generation model, which was sold from 1967 to 1996, 30 years, with of course a lot of changes along the way. The second generation came out from 1997, so this is the first year of the second generation Century, and this model was sold through 2017. So you have two generations of Century that span 50 years. And then Toyota just recently came out with the third generation Century model. But only the second generation used the V12. The original used a V8, and the newest one uses a hybrid V8. If you want the V12, you gotta get this one. And next up, since I'm outside the Century, let's start talking about the exterior quirks and features, starting with another one of its more unusual features, and that would be the styling, namely the fact that it is tremendously understated. You look at this thing, and you wouldn't think you're looking at an ultra-luxury car. In fact, the owners told me they often get it confused for a Buick because it says Century on it, and it doesn't really look that opulent. This is purely by design. Again, this is the car being used to haul around wealthy Japanese business people and politicians. They don't want something flashy. They don't need something flashy. They don't want to show off, but they do want a high-quality luxury experience, so Toyota provides it in a relatively understated wrapper. And next up, a few notable quirks of the exterior. One is the fender mirrors. You can see the mirrors are not placed in the typical spot at the base of the windshield, but instead they're on the fenders. This used to be fairly common in Japanese cars, getting much less so today, but the Century still has its mirrors on the fenders. Another notable exterior detail is the wipers. If you look at the car from the front, you'll notice you can't see them. That's because the wipers are tucked under the back of the hood where it's hinged, sort of at the base of the windshield, and they do that intentionally for wind noise. Exposed wipers, like in most other cars, can create all sorts of wind noise as air goes around them and through them, but if you tuck the wipers under, then the air passes right over the hood, and you won't get excessive wind noise. And finally, our last interesting quirk of the Century is badging. Now, the prior Century I reviewed had all sorts of majestic chickens all throughout the interior and exterior. This car has fewer. You have one on the very front on the grill, where you'd expect it. Also, all the wheel centers are majestic chickens, all four of them. Again, that isn't really that much of a surprise. And you have one more majestic chicken on the back, but they toned it down for this era of Century. Instead, you have a different kind of interesting badge throughout the exterior of this car, and that would be this Gothic C logo, which is, of course, intended to indicate Century. As you can see, it's on the very front of the hood, but you also have it on the C pillar next to the rear seats, this Gothic C, and right underneath, V12, the only exterior V12 badge on this car. Very small, very understated, but they just had to remind you somewhere that they made a V12. Another interesting badging-related item I like is the word Century printed out on the trunk in individual letters. Again, very luxurious, precisely what you'd expect from the ultra-luxury Japanese car. And one more notable item is the key. What does the key look like to the ultimate Toyota? The answer is, just like any other Lexus key from the late 90s and early 2000s, my dad has a 2005 Lexus RX, has the exact same key as the Toyota Century. Who knew? The only difference is you flip the Century key over and you have the majestic chicken, of course. My dad's Lexus key definitely does not have that printed on it. And so those are the quirks and features of the Toyota Century V12. Now it's time to get it out on the road and see how it drives. All right, driving the Century V12. I do have to say, with only 276 horsepower, it doesn't really feel like I'm driving a V12 car. But mentally, you know, I'm looking at the Toyota steering wheel, the Toyota stocks, and I'm thinking, this is a V12. It's one of the greatest mind entanglements ever. How does this make any sense? Two things you notice right when you get in the car. First thing, the engine, the powertrain, among the smoothest and quietest I have ever driven in any vehicle ever. The engine is just remarkably quiet, incredibly so. You never hear it. It never is intrusive to your life. Really amazing, actually. And I think that's the theory with the V12. You add more cylinders, a larger size, and you don't put that much power. It's just an unstressed engine that can sit at low RPM and just be quiet. But one interesting thing I've noticed is that the ride quality is not quite on the level of the engine smoothness. It is a very luxurious and smooth car, but the ride quality isn't Rolls-Royce. Even Rolls-Royce from this era, I drove a 96 Rolls Silver Spur, Silver Spirit, and it definitely rides better than this. Now, the Rolls was far more expensive. These are like $120,000, $130,000 adjusted for inflation. The Rolls was like $280,000. So it makes sense that the Rolls is more expensive. But this car does have Rolls-Royce level quietness from its powertrain, but not in terms of the driving experience. You're definitely feeling the road more. It definitely isn't quite that insulated or smooth. Another thing I'm finding interesting is the mirrors. I actually like them there. They give you a better view of the blind spots, and I think that's a pretty good spot to have the mirrors, to the point where I actually think it's better. And I suspect the reason that no one does mirrors there is because it's ugly, which it certainly is. But I hate to say it, I'm kind of into this. I like the mirrors in that position. Now, compared to the first generation Century I reviewed, this one definitely feels far more modern. It is a much, much more modern car. Everything about it, from the gauge cluster to the controls, rear seat controls, everything's more modern. The one thing that specifically isn't really all that modern is the patterning and everything in the seats. This cloth, there's like a floral pattern to it. Clearly this is made for the old school people who want these luxury cars. They're not trying any crazy new tech. They're not putting in some crazy new engine, just a low stress engine, simple controls. There was no daring decisions made with the Centuries. Same's true of its styling. Ultimately though, I have to say, I'm into this car. I really like it. The ride isn't as comfortable as I thought, but having a V12 Toyota is cool. I don't know what these are selling for, probably something like $20,000, $30,000 on the used market, maybe even less. I find it to be more interesting, more appealing than an S-Class from this era, just because it's such an unusual vehicle and I like that. The people who own this car have told me that it's been dead reliable. One or two little issues here and there, but finding parts hasn't been a problem. It's not that old. And replacing them is very simple. It has been a very reliable car. It is ultimately a Toyota, even though it's a V12. And so that's the Toyota Century V12. This is a really unusual car, a Toyota that competes with the best from BMW and Mercedes-Benz and even Rolls-Royce and Bentley. A Century is rarely seen here in North America, especially with a V12, and it has been a treat to spend the day checking out this one. And now it's time to give this Century a Doug score.
Starting with the weekend categories and styling, the Century looks so understated, which is the point, but it's certainly not beautiful, and it gets a 4 out of 10. Acceleration isn't fast, and it gets a 1 out of 10. Handling also isn't fast, again not the point, and it gets a 3 out of 10. Fun factor is low. There's some fun in driving this car because of what it is, but it's otherwise a pretty calm and composed driving experience, and it gets a 4 out of 10. Cool factor is good for a 1990s Toyota, since it's a Century with a V12, but still, most people won't know what it is, and it gets a 6 out of 10. For a total weekend score of 18 out of 50. Next up are the daily categories and features. It's reasonably well equipped and it gets a 6 out of 10. Comfort is good, but not as good as more expensive luxury models like Rolls-Royce and Bentley, and it gets an 8 out of 10. Quality is high and it gets an 8 out of 10. Practicality is normal for a sedan like this and it gets a 5 out of 10. Value is difficult to assess. These aren't readily available in North America, but they seem to be good bargains. A cool, fun, weird old Toyota with decent reliability too. It gets a 6 out of 10 for a total daily score of 33 out of 50. Added up in the Doug score is 51 out of 100, which places it here against other 90s and early 2000s luxury sedans. It beats out Rolls-Royce and Bentley models from this era, but it doesn't quite beat newer stuff like the Maybach or the Volkswagen Phaeton W12, though the Century is probably the most reliable and maybe the most interesting of this bunch.